All right. I'm Russell Shapiro, and I'm interviewing Allan Koltin today. Allan hardly needs an introduction. I'll say a few things. Top 25 thought leaders, I don't know how many years, CPA practice advisor, most influential in the accounting profession, accounting today, again, decades, I think. Most recommended consultant, 18 years. Inside Public Accounting, CPA Practice Advisor, and AAM's Hall of Fame. The bottom line is Allan is the preeminent consulting to the accounting industry. He's also a friend and confidant of mine. And we've done this once before, and the idea is to help educate people in the accounting and people interested in the accounting profession about what's going on. And so thank you for agreeing to sit down with me again, Allan.
Russ, it's my pleasure, and thanks for having me. This is our annual thing. Maybe we'll keep doing this each year. And kudos to you on all the things you become the go-to attorney, the law firm, and in the accounting space. I know you've got a whole business of representing other kinds of businesses and entities, but you have become probably the most sought-after attorney when there's an M&A deal to be had. Of all sizes.
Thank you, Allan.
You and your team just do amazing work.
Thank you. Thank you. So just to talk a little bit about you for a few minutes, you came from humble beginnings. You were a junior accountant, a local CPA firm, if I remember correctly. It was Friesbitten, Eisenstein, something and something.
Yep.
And I think you tell a story, but maybe it'd be good just to repeat it a little bit here that, you know, that maybe accounting wasn't your forte. And you found something else to do instead at that firm. Maybe it was created by you. What is the background there?
Well, as the story goes, my love was marketing.
Yeah.
But mom and dad said, you know, if you're not smart enough to be a doctor, at least be a lawyer. And if you can't be either, at least be an accountant, because God knows you always have a job.
Yeah.
Boy, were they right about that. I thought I was doing pretty well my first 6 months. Matter of fact, I thought I was going to get promoted from staff to senior. Got summoned into the managing partner's office, and he said, how do you think you're doing? I said, I think I'm doing great. What do you think? And he went in his desk drawer, and he took out the partnership agreement, and he threw it at me, and he said, why don't you take a look at paragraph 16? When I look at paragraph 16, and it talks about mandatory retirement at age 65, not about how to become a new partner. And I said to him, I think you got the wrong paragraph. He said, no, I got the right one. You asked me how long it should take for me to go from staff to senior. And based on our age 65 mandatory retirement, I don't think you'll make it. He says, I got good news and bad news. He says, the bad news is you're fired. You're the worst accountant I've ever seen. He says, the good news is I'm going to hire you back on Monday. And I said, as what? He says, I don't know. I need the weekend to figure that out. Fortunately, it was really getting brought into the management and running of the business. And at a very young age, they sort of pulled me out of the debits and credits and said, you know what? This person can help us grow the business. I was the first marketing director, first business development officer, assistant to the managing partner. And little did I know what I was really doing was taking an MBA class on how to consult to build a successful accounting firm. Thank you.
And then you started Practice Development Institute.
PDI was an outgrowth of the accounting firm. We were spending all this money on marketing. We were the country's fastest growing firm in the 80s and 90s. And we said, you know what? Other firms need this stuff. So we had a publishing division that created the niche newsletters, industry service line. We had training and leadership and business development. And we had, I'd call them technical courses on how to migrate from being a compliance provider to a profit improvement consultant or strategic planner, things like that.
Yeah, so thank you for that background. Yeah.
Thank you.
I see this beautiful chess set here. I didn't know that you were quite involved in chess as a youngster. Say what you told me earlier about.
Sure. The truth is, in those days, which is a long time ago, Bobby Fischer was the one we all aspired to be. My brother, Howie, older brother, was a nationally ranked champ. He took me under his wing, and lo and behold, I won the Wisconsin Chess Championship for consecutive years way back between the ages of 5 and 10. competed on the national circuit. And, you know, in those days, that was a game. And what I loved about it, I don't know if you saw Queen's Gambit or not,
I did.
Is it taught that. You, the game teaches you how to think strategically mm-hmm. in an unknown universe. You know, the way they used to teach us, we, a little bit like the movie, you saw, you close your eyes, you see 64 squares, mm-hmm. and you learn to dream. You learn to dream and anticipate what the other side's going to do.
Yeah. And it can really be out ahead.
Yes, yes. So you're never just thinking about the next move. You're thinking about the next 3-4 moves, and you're thinking about the variations of what the opponent could be doing.
And that's strategy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Thank
you. Yeah, maybe we'll play a game of chess.
I'm not that strategic, I guess. I'd like to be, I think I'm smart, but when I play chess, I usually realize I'm not that smart.
Well, you're a great advisor and attorney. That's good enough for me.
So actually, we had this last talk about 18 months ago. I look back at it, and it was before that there had yet been a PE deal. And you had said it was coming. And I'm like, oh, really? You sure? You know, I've heard this story before. And well, boy, were you right. We're going to talk about that a lot. But before we go there, I just want to just sort of give an overview of what's going on, you know, just regular business-wise. And then we're going to spend a lot of time on M&A and then PE as a material part of M&A. But let me just ask you just to lay the groundwork a little bit about, like, how is business for 2022? Kind of for 2021 was an incredible year, better than anyone thought, blah, blah, blah. Okay. How was 2022?
So I'm going to give you the answer, the general answer, always exceptions. You know, sometimes I'll make a statement and someone says, well, the sky must be falling because that wasn't us. You know, these are businesses. They're at different life cycles. They're in different markets, different service lines. You can't give one universal answer. But if I focused on the, you know, what we'll call the top 500 firms, firms of maybe 5 million or more, which is where we spend most of our time, it was, in the words of Larry David, a pretty, pretty good year. 2020, as we talked about, was a really good year. But I think firms knew, you know, take 15 months of revenue, put it into 12, don't spend money. If you couldn't make money in 2020, maybe look for another profession. 2021 was tweaking of the 2020 playbook. 2022, from what I can see financially, bottom line will be the best year ever for most firms, but it will also have been the most painful year. And you know where the pain is. The pain is the inability to find and keep talent. And that's not going away. So great year with an asterisk. See my dog Bucky here laying and sleeping, but they work like dogs. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's for them, they don't believe is a sustainable model. Russ Moore, 55-year-olds, burnt out than I've ever seen before, mm-hmm. saying, I don't wanna wait till 65, I wanna be done now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to go through this torture anymore. So it's an interesting year, a torturous year, but a great year financially. Go figure.
And do you see 2023 being similar or?
I do. I mean, you know, people say like, oh, there's a recession, watch out. Well, you know what? 2020, I think the first 6 months was a recession and we had our best year ever. As the wisdom of my mom and dad in 1980, always be an accountant because you'll always have a job in good and bad times. And I know we'll talk more about private equity, but I think that's one of the big attractions. They see an industry that up to a point is recession proof.
Let's talk about the staffing. Let's talk about staff compensation and partner compensation. So staffing has become, you know, just so incredibly difficult for firms. And there's all kinds of reasons for it, which we could talk about, but probably everybody knows. Is staff compensation causing margin deterioration? And is it, speak a little bit about staff compensation and partner compensation.
Well, my popularity is going to go down on this one. We're making too much money as partners. One of the reasons there's a reduction in the kids coming into public accounting. I know there's a lot of chatter on the five-year rule and great debates left and right on that. But if you just look at the options of what stars today, kids graduating, can get in the marketplace, they can make a lot more money in other professions or consulting areas. You know, if you're going to work like a dog, at least get paid for it. And our wage hasn't kept up with that. You know, I think I shared with you the interview Inside Public Accounting did with my little one, Brian, who's in the TAS group, Transaction Advisory at RSM. I think he had 64 kids graduate the Kelly Business School accounting finance program, and 52 of them chose a profession other than audit or tax. So we have got something going on where we have competition, not just from so many different areas, and we're not paying the wage we have. Even there's a population of kids going into public accounting that are bypassing audit and tax.
It's an excellent point. I also have college age and post-college age kids, and I see the same thing with their cohort, where when I was an accounting major in college, and I had offers. Ended up going straight to law school, but I had offers, and that was kind of like a really good offer with, you know, as compared to your friends who weren't accountants. Now you see a lot of these kids with technology and computers and other things like that that are making well more than the accountants. So there's a lot of competition out there for talent with that there didn't used to be. I also think that's part of the problem. Anyway. Has one last sort of generalized question. Has the in-office presence situation been settled? Like, is it settled? I know it seems to have settled down to me. Firms seem to have settled into sort of who they're going to be. What's your view on that?
I think it has settled. And I think what's settled is every firm marches to a little different drum roll. In small town America, where the office is 5 minutes and there's no compute, coming into the office, not a big thing. In New York City or LA or San Francisco, in big cities with long commutes, people are finding they can be that much more efficient working from home. You know, the great debate really now that the smoke is sort of settled is, will we have an issue in 3, 4, 5 years of that generation of young talent that wasn't properly trained because we didn't train them from their bedroom? Half the world says, we're going to have an issue. The other half says, get a life. It's changed. And change our training. And it can be done. So what I know is it's never coming back to the world we knew. This is it. And we'll see some tweaks in terms of how firms approach it. I do think it's softening up. I think a year ago, CEOs were skittish about putting out a email saying, the party's over, come back 2 to 3 days. I think today there's a warming up of, I'm coming back into the office, but make it worth my while. If it's just for us to come in and everybody closes their door and there's no interaction. So collaboration, innovation, training, team meetings, excitement, you know, celebration, a purpose for physically being together. That never used to exist. It was just, you come to the office. Now we've redefined the work experience of why one would come in. So I like where it's trending. I think there's more coming back, but it's never going to be like the world we knew.
That's what I'm experiencing in my firm as well. Before we get into M&A, any other general observations on the industry that you'd like to share?
It's the one that I always talk about, and it's the one that keeps me up at night, is 100,000 hours of consulting with the world I love, accountants. Change only happens, big change only happens in these firms when the change itself is deemed to be better than the status quo.
And there are a lot of firms right now milking it. The feeding at the trough couldn't be better. We're making great money. Therefore, what's the problem? And they can't see the light of day. They cannot see all of these trends, technology, transformation, talent, changing client wants and needs, the changing demographics of everything going on in the country. And they're blinded to the moment that they're living in. That's a problem. Great leaders plow through that. They take prisoners. They say, listen, we got to be thinking 3, 5, 7 years out. We've got to make the strategic investments today so we can thrive then. And for a lot of us, we can't see that.
A lot of people just sort of ride the wave.
Yeah. You know, there's a whole population of partners and accounting firms that measure the success of the CEO on one thing: did average partner compensation go up? If it did, they're doing a good job. And me and you know just how dumbfounded that is. It's, candidly, it's a meaningless number. But we keep hanging our hat on that, just like we keep hanging our hat on average firm turnover. We only lost 12% last year of all the talent. Yeah, but you lost 26% of your A players. What's up with that?
Or you didn't get rid of your B players.
Yes.
For C player, yeah.
Yep.
Last year was a blockbuster year. I don't know how many deals you did as compared to prior years, but I'd like to ask you that and just sort of ask you to sort of present an overview, deal volume, what's driving it, what percentage you think is PE, and how many PE firms are involved now or wanting to become involved. I know that's probably more than one question.
Yeah.
So I'll stop there.
So it's off the chart. The number of private equity groups that wants to be in the accounting profession. We were warned about this back in 2020. The whispering was, once one cracks the code, they all want in. Well, Eisner Amper, Tower Brook happened. Shellman and Lightyear Capital happened. Citrin Cooperman and New Mountain Capital happened. Cherry Beckert and Parthenon happened. Smith and Howard and BroadSky. And interestingly, we saw firms as small as 40 million or 50 million all the way up to 500 million. Game on. But what's happened in the private equity space is just like professional boxing with heavyweights, middleweights, welterweights, you've got private equity groups now on the big stage. If you're not a firm of 500 million in revenue or above, they don't want to talk to you. There's that group. There's a second group that says 100 million to 500 million of revenue, that's our sweet spot, the middleweights. And now you've got the welterweights coming in. That could be family office as well. I'm working with some where they're saying, give us 2 to 3 million of EBITDA, and you only got to be about a $10 million firm to pull that off, maybe a little bit bigger, and we want in. So this transformation, by the time we're done, I don't even think we're going to resemble what we look like today. Unlike the great consolidators of the late 90s, there were a couple of them, and that was it. It really didn't transform our industry. This will, and I think it'll do it for the right reasons.
And so how many PE firms are you currently working with?
Well, I've got signed engagement letters with 40 of them. So I get 40 calls a week saying, what'd you do for me lately? I would tell you that I'm getting a lot better at dissecting, and it's probably a question you'd love to ask is, how do you decipher a great private equity group from a good one, from a...
Well, actually, I had the question, it was later on, like, is what is the right private equity firm? Is there a right private equity firm? I know you sort of talked about stratification in terms of size. And you'll, I imagine, have, you know, a few at
one size, a few at another size, a few at another size, that will end up being players. But is there a character of a private equity firm? Is there anything about accounting firms that sort of require a private equity firm to think differently about things?
Great question, Russ. So me and you spend a lot of time advising accounting firms, more times sellers, going into bigger firms. And we talk about the big three, don't we? We say it's got to be a culture fit, right? Number two, it's got to be a strategic fit. And number three, it's got to be good economically. Guess what? It's the same three criteria in evaluating a PE group. A great PE group makes a statement to the target: you were wildly successful before we met you. We don't have a great need to micromanage your business. We have day jobs also. We want to be your capital and strategic partner. What does that mean when you say you want to be our strategic partner? Because last time I looked, I'm in the business of growing and building as an accounting firm. And the PE group, you're in the business of growing EBITDA. I want to spend, you want to maximize. Mm-hmm. Are we strategically aligned? You have to talk through that, and you have to find the partner that together says, I love your story. If only you had capital, this is what you could build. Mm-hmm. Let's go do it together. That's a great strategic partner with a cultural fit, and then the economics, right? If I'm a PE group and I just want to grow EBITDA and get the heck out and send it to the next PE group, that's going to run counter to a firm that's $100 million that wants to grow to $300 million. A $500 million firm that wants to become a billion, or a billion that wants to become $2 billion. Alignment of strategic goals, cultural fit, economic fit.
Okay. So you've got the PE firm buying an accounting firm. That's what we'll call the platform deal. Then after the platform deal, there's a lot of add-on deals. We saw a lot of EisenRamper. We saw a lot of Citrin Cooperman deals this year. Sort of first bigger firms out of the block being very active in the market, sort of doing what I think in the PE world they call add-ons. Okay. How, when you're, for the audience here that may, are potential sellers, like how are the PE, think, let's assume they're not going to be a platform firm. How are the PE deals, the deals with PE firms that are PE backed now, how are those deals look different from the traditional deal with an accounting firm?
Help me out. You mean how does the, from whose perspective?
From the seller's perspective.
Yeah.
So when, if the seller has a choice of a traditional accounting firm,
yes,
versus a PE backed accounting firm, how do those deals look different, if at all? Yeah. And I think then we'll get into, are they starting to come together?
Yeah.
So speak to that a little bit.
So it's interesting. This last 2 years, we've had PE-owned CPA firms beat what we call the mere mortals, right? They just wanted on the economic side. Everything else was a wash. And we've had the mere mortals, you know, those that aren't interested in PE, beat PE-owned firms. And you say, well, what's up with that? Well, what's up with that is if a firm produces enormous EBITDA, they're probably going to go the way of PE because they can. They can take a haircut. They can scrape their comp down, still make a pretty good living, and monetize and, you know, get the benefits of that.
They capitalize their excess earnings.
You got it. And then there are some that don't produce enough profit. And I say, I feel bad. I feel like a loan officer at the bank, but you don't qualify for the loan. You're not PE worthy. I should probably find a nicer way to say that, right? But yes, that's, there are firms that are better aligned with non-PE owned firms. So what do we try to do? And you know, we do this all the time, is we try to take the money off the table. We try to normalize the economics. So we're marrying for love, not for money, right? It's nice if the money's nice, but let's figure out the best cultural and strategic fit and then try to make the economics work.
One of the other things we've seen, though, is that some of the traditional acquirers are starting to use money now to compete with the PE firms. I don't see a lot doing that, but I see some doing that. Do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, it's isn't it funny, Russ, after 40 years of the same deal, you know, two and a half times, maybe three times, your average earnings paid over 10 years as ordinary income, and then different derivatives of that, we now have many, many different deals. We have the PE deal. We have the multiple of comp deal. We have the AAV as the business grows, your ownership times that increases yours. We have the annuity of for life. And we now have a new one called blank sheet of paper. Let's whiteboard this. What is it you want? Who would have ever thought a stodgy conservative, you know, follow the playbook profession like the accounting profession would have made that statement? And what's happened in the boardrooms is they've gotten religion. There's a third of those firms that have said, you know what? An outsider is going to get a better deal than an insider. Because if we come into Seattle, Washington with a $20 million firm, someday that'll be $100 million. If we don't put that better deal on the table, they're not budging. They're not moving. And we'll go put our flag in the ground in Seattle, Washington, and in 3 years, we'll be doing $1 million. So firms have gotten religion. There's a second group that says, no, no, no. You come join us, you get what we get, and we're going to hold court there. And then there's a third group in the middle that sort of does a hybrid. They say, let's figure this out. What is the wants and needs of the partners? What does it take to get a deal done?
So when you get one of the traditional firms, you know, firms have historically been debt averse. Mm-hmm. We get a traditional firm that says, look, I want to play and get some of these higher profit firms, and I know I'm going to have to pay cash. Okay, they just going to the bank and saying, give me $100 million to do these deals?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think the great disruptor historically was CBiz because they had more cash than anybody. One could argue almost like unfair playing field. I think in recent years, if you look on the big stage, the top 20 firms, I would have to say Marcum has been a disturber. They've done what their clients do. They went to the bank, they borrowed debt, and they said, we're going to play ball just like a business, not like an accounting firm. And then you've seen other firms, you know, the problem with mentioning one is you're going to get, I'm going to get texts when this comes out. Why didn't you mention our firm? But, you know, you're seeing other firms saying, you know what? We're now going down the path of offering cash as well. So, yeah, it's what a great time to be looking, if you are looking in the M&A world. Deal values, we get to see them all. It's off the chart.
I want to talk to you about pricing.
Yeah.
That's actually my next question. So how do you think about pricing? You know, traditionally, and traditionally just means like 18 months ago, okay, for, and then 40 years before that, okay, or 100 years before that, I don't even know. But a long time before that, ever since I've been in this world, it's sort of like, you come over, you know, if I have a 3X retirement multiple on comp, then that's what you get. Maybe you can keep your receivables or something like that. Okay. And maybe you had a 2.5, now you're going to a 3. Maybe you had a 2.5 and you're going into a 2.5, but it's a more stable firm and you sort of secure your retirement payment. Okay. Now we're talking about sort of pricing that may incorporate that, but it may also incorporate cash. It may incorporate some sort of equity units with the PE firms. How do you sort of just think about how accounting firms are valued?
Well, we all like to say and pound our chest that we're getting one times revenue, which you and me both know is not true, right? The traditional deal is I'm age 55. I don't get a dollar until 65. And then you're going to slowly pay me over 10 years till 75. Present value that number back, that's not one times revenue. That's 60, 70 cents on a dollar. That's the deal. But we frame it like it's equivalent of one times revenue because we use gross dollars. You know, I think the biggest mystery, Russ, is going to be the value of rollover equity.
Mm-hmm.
Because that can be a game changer. You know, if it's worth an increase of 2 or 3 times, that's pretty good. If it moves 4, 5, 6, 7 times, that's off the chart. You know, we've got some early precincts reporting, right? We've got Eisner, we've got Citrin. I think those are the two this farthest down. And, you know, without betraying any trade secrets, the meter has moved. If they came in at 1.0, it's lifted to about 1.7 in the first year with projections for going more. And you logically would say to me, well, how can that be? It's an accounting firm. Right. Well, you know what? Better decisions, tougher decisions, faster decisions, run more like a business, deeper investments in areas we used to dream of, we can now make.
Well, that I think is, that relates to another question I was going to ask you, but I'll just sort of reframe that. One of the questions I get a lot of times when representing a seller is, look, this is great for the older generation, but is it good for the younger generation? Well, because the younger generation is going to get more equity and the older is going to get more cash generally. So you agree with that? And so then the question becomes, okay, well, what is it about a relationship with a PE firm that's going to help create value to make those units ultimately worth a multiple of what they were issued at? And I think you just spoke to that.
What I hope where you're going here is the difference between the old partner and the young.
That is part of what I'm talking about. Because sometimes there's a dichotomy. The old, I've seen so many variations of this, so I don't want to like say there's one. Some variations are the old people are happy because they're getting all this cash. And the young people question it. Other times, the old people are concerned, well, the younger people aren't getting enough cash. I'm worried about that. Sometimes the young people want the equity. I've just seen it sort of all over the board, you know, and part of it is, well, does the story work?
Yeah.
Okay, and we hope the story works. We think the story works, but there has to be value creation. Okay, there has to be value creation that may have happened without the PE firm, but you'd think that for the PE firms to sort of earn its return, that they'd have to have that much more enhanced value creation through use of financial leverage, potentially through better decision-making, you know, all the things, some of the things you've talked about, maybe some things I'm not yet aware of.
So I think the story of the year is the mindset of the young superstar. And I think all roads lead back to that. Now, if I may, I'll give two.
Please.
One comes from a young partner. I'm sitting in a meeting with Cherry Becker, newer firms, to go to the younger. And the younger partner says, he says, Mr. Koltin, he said, you know, our generation sees the world quite different than your generation. He said, you took a job and you were willing to sit there for 40 years. And if you made it to 65 and the firm was still in business and the profession was still around, you thought you won the lottery because you got 2 times compensation that were slowly going to get paid to you over 10 years until age 75. I said, you're right. He says, well, that ain't us. He says, I'm 38 years old. I just got a check, a 7-figure check with capital gain treatment that I wasn't going to get for 27 years. And you know what? We've got some EBITDA milestones for the next 3-4 years. If we hit those, I'm going to get a second check. And you know what? I've got rollover equity, pari passu, same rights, same privileges as the PE firm. And when they sell their investment in 5 to 7 years, I'm going to consider selling mine. I can either cash out, I can sell half and roll over half, or I can roll the whole thing over. But here's the interesting thing. At age 45, I can go do something different with my life if I want to, because I can. That's the mindset of the generation today. They're not going to be a slave for 40 years and wait for the gold watch. I think we have to take notice of that. And the second, and you know this, is the stars today are pushing back on crappy work. We've talked about this, right? The first time I did a tax return, great. I did it 15 times. I'm now an expert. If you think I'm going to sit here and do 1,500 of them, not a prayer. The average worker will gladly do it. Just treat me fairly. Pay me a good wage. Don't scream at me. Don't tell me I have to work nights and weekends. I just threw that in there. But you say, you look at PE, and they have the capital to go to India or the Philippines or South Africa and literally overnight buy a transformational business that work can get done at $25 an hour versus the $125 we have to pay to burn out those great people doing boring work. Today, they'll show us. They'll go somewhere else where they don't have to do it. So that's should be keeping us up at night.
Those are good points. Let me ask you a question. We have an environment of increasing interest rates right now. Do you think that is going to have an effect on pricing or activity in general?
Yeah, great question, Russ, and it has. So if I reflect on 2022, the year that just ended, you know, the press releases always talk about the deals that get done. We don't put out a press releases when deals fail. And I do believe that the doubling of the cost of debt was a factor in some of these deals not getting to a finish line. I would tell you that, though, I see three kinds of private equity groups. I see the one that's closed. They say, Allan, the capital markets are closed right now. Let's come back to this in spring or summer, mm-hmm. and let's reevaluate. And there's a whole population of PE firms that fit that bill. There's a second one that says, look, when we started talking, the deal we put on the table 9 months ago, the universe has changed. We can't give you that deal structured the way it is, but we are going to give you that enterprise value, but we're not going to give you as much cash at close. We're going to spread it out, and we're going to put some hooks in there over it. Nothing major, but you got to work with us on this. And then amazingly, there's the third PE firm out there that says, you know what? We're in this for 5, 10, 12 years. We think it's a great marriage. The deal is the deal. We'll honor it. And those firms sometimes win the deal because they stay in there, they do the work, they sort of bypass the competition, and that's how they win the deal. So how we say no one accounting firm is created the same, no one PE firm is the same. All different propensities of risk and reward.
Could we get to pricing just one more time here? So some people, sellers out there, may be saying, well, what am I going to get from my firm? Like, I'll do whatever gets me the money, okay? And like, what could they expect? You talked about this scrape. The scrape is sort of like, how much am I making as an owner above what I'd make as a worker or something like that? So if somebody's, you know, talent would get them 600,000 in the market, but they're making 900,000, they'd be able to take that 300 and sort of get a multiple on it, okay? What do people expect on that multiple, and how is that scrape amount determined?
All right, so Russ, you just asked seven questions in one question there. That's a lot to hear on. So let's break it down a little bit. So the multiples, that's the sexy thing. Those of you new to private equity, it's an algebraic equation, right? It's multiple times EBITDA is enterprise value. And then we figure out how to pay the enterprise value. So if you're a sponsor, right, the multiples I've seen as low as 8, not that that's low. I've seen them as high as 15. I've seen them average out somewhere around 11. If you're a great firm, you're going to trade at the high end. If you're a good firm, you'll be right in the middle. If you're just an okay firm, maybe a bit lower. There's a second variable that impacts that, size of them, right? The economic dependence on a key individual versus a big, big firm. And there's probably a third one in there, which has to do with the mix of the services that you have and just your overall profitability and the markets you're in, you know? So you have all that. That's just the multiple piece, the EBITDA piece. Firms would say roughly take 14-15% of firm revenues, and your EBITDA should be somewhere around that range. So if you're a $100 million firm, you'd be $15 million of EBITDA. You know, like it's like one times revenue. It's a starting point. If I have a lot of older partners close to the finish line and they happen to be some of my higher paid partners, I can probably move that 14% up to 20%. If I've got a really young group and I don't have any real high income earners, probably not a lot to pull, not a lot to scrape from comp. So, you know, the battlefield on EBITDA, as you know, is about strategic things we can accomplish together that individually we can't. Mm-hmm. And it's who owns that. Mm-hmm. So when we're going through sort of the calculation, you know, we're looking at talent. We're looking at things that maybe we can eliminate. We don't need to spend on anymore because the bigger ship has it. And then there's this third one of things we can accomplish together. And that's sort of a tug of war, where sometimes the acquirer says in a nice way to the acquiree, that's why we're doing this. We're in business to make money too. Sometimes they say, you're right. If you can eliminate that lease, God knows we got more than enough space. We'll split the difference. Or sometimes they'll simply say, you know what? That couple million dollars you spent on that lawsuit last year, you're not going to do that again. That's pure EBITDA. You can add it back. You should have made that money.
Yeah.
All right. Let me get on a few other questions here.
Yep.
Is what's happening in the M&A market affecting internal buyout pricing at all?
Oh, Russ, you are good, man. You should do this for a living. Screw the attorney. You should just do these interviews. Yeah, it's a little bit of a quiet civil war going on. You know, where there's been a wake-up call to older partners that this business is actually worth something. Go figure. Who thought that? We're working on one right now in the East Coast. In a million years, they never conceived the enterprise value could trade at what it is today. And they're saying almost like, thank God we didn't do something a couple of years ago because this is fantastic. Now let's go do it. What it calls into question is, if we don't do it now and we leave it to the kids, I'm just putting it out there like it is, and then the kids go sell it in a couple of years and get the windfall, well, what about everything we did? Look, you're aware, you know, I would say most of the big four firms, but we'll just use E&Y because that's the one that's at least out there publicly. You know, I've got a group of retired E&Y partners who are very upset, knowing that by the end of next year, E&Y could sell to a PE group, the tax and consulting group, and the audit, you know, goes off on its own.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's sort of got their hand out a little bit, right? Hey, we're audit. If you really want this, you know what? We deserve to get a premium because we'll be just an audit firm. Tax and consulting, you're going to do amazing, right? But then what about the retired partners, the alumni, the feeders, the builders, to get them to where they are? You know, and if you say to them like, well, okay, you know what we're going to do? We're going to take your risk off the table. All those future payments we're going to give you, we'll present value it and you get it today. No risk. And you know what they're saying? Not good enough. Not good enough. We're entitled to something more.
So, well, a lot of times what people will want to do in their partnership agreements is have a provision that says that if there is a sale within so many years after I retire, I'll get some piece of it. I'll get some compensation from it, maybe on a decreasing sliding scale, depending on when that sale is. Is there any interest in minority investments by PE firms and accounting firms? Have you seen that? I haven't seen it, but I'm curious as to whether you've seen it.
So there's one or two going on right now, but probably others, but I'm aware of one or two. And it's there's an openness by private equity. I would tell you that they might say that the multiple goes down, because they're a little bit more at risk as a minority partner. I would tell you some of the PE firms have said, look, whatever it's going to take to get a deal, but trust us, if we're a 49% owner, we have as much power as a 51% owner. You know, things never, and you know this, they never really come to formal votes. We work through it to figure it out. My thing, when I ask sometimes the firm, why do you want a minority interest? It's almost as if it's the optics of the press release. We don't want to say we sold. We don't want to say we were acquired. We want to be able to say somebody took a minority interest in our business. And I'm like, you know what? 2 seconds after the press release comes out, it's old news. Do what's best for the business. And sometimes to make these deals economically work, you want to sell more than 40% of the business. It makes sense to sell 60, 70% of the business. So I'm not hardline minority or majority. I'm hardline, what's the number we need to make this worthwhile for the stakeholders?
That makes sense. Let me ask another related question. So if you got these PE firms, I've had one firm come to me and say, well, can't I do this myself? Can't I go get leverage from a bank if I want it, pay out some money to partners, maybe have some money to invest, maybe have more of a an equity structure than sort of a retirement structure? Can I do this myself? Can I, in fact, do a, I'll call it a leverage buyout, but it's not exactly that. Have you seen that, thought about it?
I'm laughing, Russ, because you just defined 2022. More meetings with top 400 firms where we take out a flip chart and we put down the big five. We have five options. Strategic. Number one, put our head back in the sand. Let's just keep plowing until we can't. Most good firms are smart enough to know that that's not sustainable. Number two, let's go get acquired by a PE-owned CPA firm. Number three, forget about that. Let's be the foundation firm, right? Number four, let's merge up, but not with PE. Let's go with the mere mortals and pick the best in class, the best strategic and cultural fit there is. And the last one, you just hit it, let's go to the bank, borrow money, lever the balance sheet, and do what they do. I have yet to see option five come to fruition. We are mostly accountants.
It's theoretically possible.
It is possible, but we're conservative in nature. And, you know, that's where you get a little bit into the old guard maybe doesn't want to take a lot of debt on in those later years. And then the interesting thing is the young guard doesn't want to take on a lot of debt. So that
aversion to debt
is, yes, that one is always talked about, rarely or never actually executed upon. I mean, the question, Russ, there's firms that don't think you need capital in today's world. Why? What's all the chatter? Why can't we just keep milking what we're milking? The feeding at the trough is great. It'll always be like that. Let's do it till we can't. Well, you can do that, but you're going to wake up one day and maybe be in a position of weakness.
So, one comment, then one last question. We've talked a lot about PE, which has really changed the landscape and done a lot of deals. And there's still a lot of the regular deals going on. If I look at the 20 deals I did or something like that last year, there's probably still close to half of them that are the traditional model.
Yeah.
I'm a firm. I like the traditional model. I want a partnership. I want to just go to a bigger firm that's investing more. A lot of that's still happening, similar, maybe with a teaser of cash, okay? A lot of that's still happening. I just want to mention that and ask you to confirm it. And then I'll go on to one final question.
Yeah, lots of deals with PE not involved, not even considered. It's the other reasons of transformation, technology, talent, capital. And those deals are going to continue to go on. I think 2023, bold prediction, will be as busy in terms of pure number of deals as 2022. Maybe more. You know, the unknown is a little bit the murkiness of the recession.
So one last question. So you have a firm that comes to you and says, Allan, we're making a lot of money. We feel like we have a partnership that wants to invest. Okay. We like each other and we want to continue to sort of be independent. What do you tell them they need to do in order to do that? How do you help them do that? That's what they're
saying. It's all about governance. It's about running it like a business. It's making tough decisions. So when, and I think you know this, we have an M&A business, but we have a real consulting business. We just don't put press releases out when we work with firms. But I think if the number one thing we've been doing in these strategic planning sessions with boards and partners has been to talk about changes to how we operate. You know, what do I love about your firm? Levenfeld Perlstein, LP Legal, built for speed, right? They need to become built for speed to make the tough decisions faster and run a better mousetrap. And to do that, this partnership model, which is one of the reasons private equity got into it, has been exposed. It is a dysfunctional way to run a business. 20 people sit around the table, and if those three don't want to do it, even though these 17 do, we're going to back off because we're nice people, because we're collaborators. I mean, who runs a business like that? So putting real power into leadership, not being an administrative partner, being a CEO, managing partner, what that means is managing the partners. I always say to the firms when I start, you know this, who's running your firm? Are the partners running the firm? Or is the firm running the partners? Guess which one always performs better? Yeah. That's the calling. You don't have to do anything except for run a better business.
Excellent advice, Al. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you for
enjoying our relationship, and I enjoyed this interview.
I appreciate it. Thanks, and have a great 2023.
You too.
Love working with you.
Likewise.
Thanks.